using slides for presentation, but I won't be presenting them in the conventional sense. So you will be seeing the slides in the video frame itself. So it's suggested that you please pin the video frame so that the slides are more visible. So I won't be presenting it in the convincing sense. Just I repeat, it will be coming through the video itself. So my thumbnail will be coming along with the slides. Before commencing, which language do you prefer? Should we continue in English or shall I switch to Malayalam? Which language would you prefer?
So you can move on with English, I guess.
Yes, okay. So am I visible to you now? I have switched on the video now.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's move on. So topic we are going to discuss today is the untold motions in the solar system. As you know, our solar system is full of motions. A lot of things are in motion, and all of them are basically conceived to be rotational motion. So we all have, usually these type of lectures, when we think about them, we think that we are expecting some complex idea to be presented in a simple way. Okay, so if that is your criterion of a good presentation, this will be a very bad presentation, because we all have a very good idea about what a solar system is. You have a very simple picture that has been in your mind since your early childhood. From the very small classes of your education, you have been given an idea about the solar system, and you all know what the solar system is. And today in this session, we are actually going to complicate things a bit. So in that sense, you will be having a very bad presentation in the conventional sense. We are going to talk about some motions that are very complex, which are often untold or unaccounted for in popular discussions. Okay, so let's delve directly into the topic now. This is the picture of our solar system in our mind. It's a perfect solar system with the star sun at its center, and there is orbiting planets around it. Well-defined orbits, you can see them. You can see the planets are all orbiting in a single plane, and planets have a well-defined orbit. They are all very ordered. The motions are very ordered. In a sense, we can say that there is a group of perfect motions in the solar system. So if you ask what solar system is, the first thing that anyone will answer is that the sun and 8 planets constitute the solar system. And if you want to go into more details, someone might be adding satellites, maybe asteroids, comets, etc. to the picture. But no one usually argues about the complexity of the motions involved. So what is so complex about the motions that we are going to discuss? That is what we are going to familiarize right now. So let us list out the motions that we are all familiar with. What are the motions that you are all familiar with? Okay, let us start from the very obvious one. Earth rotates about its own axis. So we call it a spin. When some object or rotates about an axis that is passing through its own body, we call it spin. So Earth has a spin. So that is one of the most simplest of all motions. We understand it. We recognize it daily because it is the main reason behind the day-night cycles. Now, the second one is the Earth's revolution around sun. And that is responsible for our seasons. And we have divided time into years. And 1 year is a period of time that Earth takes to complete one's complete revolution around sun. Now, another motion is the moon revolving around Earth. And of course, there are other planets revolving around sun. There are satellites revolving around their parent planets. And our moon revolver is one of the natural satellites in the solar system. And these are all the obvious motions. And if you look at it, there are only two types of motions involved: spins and revolutions. Okay, this is the simplistic picture of Earth, Moon, Sun system. Earth rotates about its own axis, or Earth has a spin, and Earth is revolving around Sun in an orbit, and Moon is revolving around Earth. These three motions are the most familiar ones, and these are actually the basis of our calendar and clock system. So can you have you ever discussed anything, any motion beyond the spin and revolution, whether it's the spin of planets, whether it's the spin of satellites, whether it's the revolution of planets around the Sun, or the revolution of satellites around planets? Are there other motions to be considered? If you look at history, this motion of planets and satellites, at that time there was only one satellite known, that is Moon, and the motion of these bodies in the sky, that the celestial objects that we see in the night sky, these the motion of these bodies were a long-standing mystery, and how these objects move, why these objects are moving, these were the very long-standing mysteries of the time. And the first person to have a revolutionary breakthrough in this aspect was none other than Isaac Newton. He came up with his law of gravitation and his law of motion. The two famous equations from that contribution is given here, F is equal to gm1 m2 by r square, and F is equal to ma. These are the very popular equations, very unique equations that everyone remembers even after passing out from their schools and colleges. And gm1 m2 by r square is referring to the universal law of gravitation, where Newton says every two masses with masses m1 and m2 will have an attractive force towards each other, and r being the distance separating them. So F is equal to gm1 m2 by r square. And the next one is the an equation of a motion, where he connects force with the motion. Here acceleration stands for an attribute of motion, and he says that acceleration is caused by force. So what we remember most about Newton is his story, maybe the notorious story of an apple falling onto his head. But there is no historical record that suggests that Newton had an apple on his head, but rather the picture is that Newton got inspired by the motion of a falling apple, and then he generalized that idea to the motion of Moon. So when you saw an apple falling onto ground, to formulate or to hypothesize that the Earth is attracting it towards itself is not a revolutionary idea. It doesn't take the genius of Newton to know about that. Newton's genius came to the picture when you recognize that Newton thought the same force that is responsible for an apple or falling apple is responsible for the motion of Moon. Because at that time, Moon and things above Moon were considered to be heavenly matters, where humans had no role, humans had no influence or control. They were considered to be heavenly. And Newton was the first one to revolutionize science by extrapolating human ideas to the celestial objects. So an apple is a very daily, an ordinary object. Newton said that the motions of an ordinary object like apple and a celestial object like Moon are governed by essentially the same rule of nature, the gravity. And this is where Newton's genius came forward, and he came up with this brilliant equation, and he went on to the generalization that this does not apply to apple and Moon alone. It applies to every body in the universe. Every body with mass will exert a force on another, the force being given by the expression gm1 m2 by r square. So this is the first grand insight generated by Newton, where this motion of planets and satellites could be explained in detail, with an accuracy that was never ever even imagined of. And coming to the motion of planets, this is one example where Newton's idea the power of Newton's formulation can be seen. In today's world, when we are living in the 21st century, it doesn't make much sense to over appreciate some simple equation. But at that time, when these planets were completely mystery to the common people, Newton's equations could predict the existence of a planet. It was somewhere around the middle of 18th century that we noted that there is something, some aspect of the motion of Uranus, the planet Uranus, was behaving mysteriously, because the motion of Uranus could not be completely described by the equation G M1 M2 by R square. Okay, why Uranus is behaving like that? That question was explored by so many scientists of that time, and some people came up with a hypothesis that there might be another planet out there beyond the orbit of Uranus that might be causing Uranus to misbehave in the sense that it does not match very well with the prediction of Newton's theory. And with this assumption, people could work out where the position of that unknown planet might be. And when telescopes were turned in that direction, they could actually spot a planet, which was later named Neptune. So this at that time, it was a very remarkable thing to achieve, because you were predicting a new celestial object that was never seen before, but could be predicted before it was discovered. And the idea that why Neptune could be predicted, or why Neptune can influence the motion of Uranus, the secret lies in the fact that in this equation, the M1 and M2 need not necessarily be a sun and a planet. When we are often introduced to this equation in +1 or +2 level physics, we often consider an example of a planet orbiting a sun or a satellite orbiting a planet. But we should keep in mind that Newton's law is actually a universal law of gravitation, and M1 and M2 can be any object. They need not necessarily be a sun-planet pair or a planet-satellite pair. So every planet, every satellite will exert gravitational force towards each other. So when Neptune comes close to the Uranus, Neptune and Uranus will attract each other. And depending, since both of them are primarily in the attractive force of sun, which are simultaneously moving around sun, the nature of the force will vary depending upon the positions of these planets in their respective orbits. So this is the first anomaly. This kind of deviation from motion is often called the gravitational perturbations in the orbits of planets. Now we should move on to the next idea of a gravitational field, where the idea of a field is important, because Newton's theory, G M1 M2 by R square, is actually a simplistic idea which assumes that M1 and M2 are objects with a perfectly spherical symmetry, which are solid, so that they can be approximated as a point source of gravity. Okay. Those details are often not given in a +2 higher secondary level education, but it is usually assumed, these equations assume that the M1 and M2 are perfectly spherical objects, solid spherical objects, so that they can be modeled as a point source of gravity, and there is no ambiguity in the measurement of R. If they can be approximated as a point sources, the distance measurement between two points is very straightforward, so there is no ambiguity involved in the definition of R. But if you go on to the actual situation of planets and satellites, they are not at all perfectly spherical, they are not all solid objects, and there are a lot of anomalies, lot of deviations from the perfect assumptions made in the Newton's law of gravity. So that is why in today's world, we do not often use these equations directly. Instead, we invoke the idea of a gravitational field. These gravitational fields are used to model the gravitational field of objects. When you are talking about rocket launches, etc., we model the rockets and the field in which these rockets are moving with a complex Earth, which is not at all spherical, which has a lot of deviation from the perfect symmetry. And one of the most notable deviation from the symmetry is nothing but the equatorial bulge. What is an equatorial bulge? We know that all planets are actually having a spin. These spins are fast enough that during the formation of these planets, they were molten balls of metal. So when such things are rotating very fast, we can expect that there is a centrifugal force at action. And this centrifugal force will cause the equatorial regions of the spheres to bulge out. So they will be, they will not be looking like perfect spheres. Rather, they may be modeled as a shape called oblate spheroid. Okay, so without rotation, the gravity would cause these planets to form a perfectly spherical symmetry. But since they are all rotating about their own axis, they have a bulge, an equatorial bulge. If you look at outer planets like Jupiter, Uranus, and Saturn through telescope, you can clearly distinguish this equatorial bulge in their images. And another aspect deals with the dynamic nature of the planet. The planet has a lot of dynamic aspects like a redistribution of water when seasons change. During winters, the polar ice caps become very large. And during summer season, these ice caps melt and the water is redistributed in other parts of the ocean. And there are, as we all know, that the solid part of the Earth constitutes only the core of the planet. And out there, below this core, we have a mantle that is liquid in state. And there is another core, which is very much molten, such that there is nothing so solid about Earth except the crust part. Even in the crust, it does not exist like a continuum, but it is it exists in the form of discrete plates. And there are plates in a... when these pieces of crust are actually situated on molten rock, they are not at all stable. So they will simply rub against each other and there will be elastic energies involved. And there are a lot of dynamic aspects of this planet, which makes this it impossible to model Earth as a perfectly spherical point source of gravity. This can be attributed as one of the major reasons for the imperfect motions that we are going to discuss today. This is not just applicable to Earth, this is applicable to all planets, satellites, and even to the Sun. So first imperfection that we need to is the spin, which is actually having a tilted axis. The Earth has a an axis about which it is undergoing a spin, but this axis, the axis of rotation, is not at all perpendicular to the plane on which Earth's orbit is lying. It has a tilt of around 23.5 degrees, and it is not at all perpendicular. The plane on which the Earth's orbit is actually lying is called ecliptic plane, and the reference from which the axial tilt, the tilt of Earth's axis, is measured is nothing but the normal to this ecliptic plane. So why this? Not just Earth, almost all planets have axial tilt, and this tilt is assumed to be the result of a violent history of our solar system. During the formation of the solar system, the solar system was not as calm as it is today. It was made up of hundreds of planetesimals that were colliding against each other. Some of them just coalesced to form bigger chunks of matter, which became the planets. Some of them just scattered to form asteroids. And it took millions of years for the planets and planetesimals to have a stable configuration as we see today. So at that time, mutual collisions were very frequent, and the axial tilt of planets is a reason or were a result of this violent past of our solar system. And if we extend the axis of Earth out into space, we know that when Earth is rotating about its axis, everything else will appear to be revolving around it. And that is the basic reason behind every celestial object rising in the east and setting at the west. So if there is one object directly above or directly oriented towards the axis of our Earth, that object, there are two ends to the axis. If you have two objects at these ends, these objects will be exceptions because they won't be affected by the rotation of Earth. So you won't see them rising and setting. You will see them at a constant position in the sky. But there is only one object at the northern end of Earth's axis. That is called Polaris, which is a star. And we call it a pole star because it is situated directly above the point on Earth where the axis is passing through the surface of Earth. So it won't be affected by the rotation of Earth or the spin of Earth. So it will not rotate. So we do not have a star above the South Pole. So we have only one pole star right now, which is called a pole star. So moving forward, we just said that the Earth's axis is fixed in space so that we have a pole star. But actually, this is not true because the axis itself is undergoing a kind of motion that is called a precession. The way you see it in the slide, the axis has a tilt, which is actually the tilted axis is forming a cone-shaped path in space because the axis is itself. This type of motion is called a precession. This precession is very slow in nature because to complete one rotation, it takes 26,000 years. So how will we recognize this motion? This motion was recognized in far before modern science came to world, because precise observation can actually reveal the precessional motion of Earth's axis. As we say that Polaris is the pole star now, but if you go to the future, around 15,000 years to the future, Earth's axis will point towards another star, Vega, which is a very bright star in the visible to the sky. Due to this precessional motion of Earth's axis, in the future, we will have a different star as the pole star. If we look at our prehistoric documents or even written documents of ancient civilization, we can see that they refer to another star as the pole star, because at that time, Earth's axis was pointing towards a different star, which is not Polaris. So this is how we understand precession. When Earth's axis undergo precession, the Polaris or the pole star appear to change. Sometimes there may not be a pole star at all, because the direction at which Earth's axis points will not have a star in the sky. So we need to add another component to this precession, because as in the previous, you can see that the axis or the end of the Earth's axis seem to form, or the locus of that end seem to form a perfect circle, but actually it is not circular in nature. It's kind of a corrugated nature, because it is undergoing another kind of motion where, as I said, this axial tilt is not moving like this. Even this angle is changing like this. There is a sine component in the precessional motion here, and that component is called a nutation. It's not mutation, it's N, nutation. So this is primarily due to the non-alignment of orbital planes of Earth and Moon. The plane on which Earth's orbit around the Sun lies, and the plane on which Earth's Moon's orbit around Earth plays, they are not perfectly in alignment. So this causes some disturbance to the precessional motion of Earth's axis. And the period of that nutational motion is 18.6 years, with an amplitude of 9.2 arc second. An arc second is a very small quantity. If you want to have an idea, this one complete circle is a 360 degree, which is actually 2 pi radian. Okay, and one arc minute is 1/16th of a degree, and one arc second is 1/16th of a minute. So in a sense, one arc second is 1/3600 of a degree. So this is a very small amplitude motion, but it is not zero. That is what we need to consider. If you want to have a true picture of the motions involved, we need to consider nutation also. So a precession combined with nutation will give you an idea about the nature of Earth's axis. Now, moving forward, there is another wobbling motion involved, which is called a Chandler wobble. Chandler is an American scientist who is responsible for this discovery. This is another kind of nutation. This is essentially a kind of nutation where the tilt of Earth's axis is changing, but it has a period of 433 days, around over an year, and the amplitude is very small. If you look at it, it's just 9 meters on the surface of Earth. And the reason for this is 9 meters is a very small compared to the size of an Earth. 9 meters is very much a human dimension considered to the celestial dimension of an Earth. But the reason for this is due to the changes in the mass distribution or angular momentum of Earth's outer core and atmosphere oceans, as we have discussed earlier. It is not at all a solid stationary object. It has a lot of dynamic aspects involved. There is another motion called a polar motion. And this is nothing but the motion of Earth's rotational axis relative to its crust. Okay, so there is an axis of rotation for Earth. It will be penetrating Earth's crust at two points. But these points actually vary with time. It's of a meter of very few meters, and it is not at all periodic. It changes from time to time. It is due to the motions of the Earth's core and mantle, and partly due to the redistribution of water mass. So if you want to look at a point on the surface of Earth where the axis of Earth is penetrating, that point varies. The points varies from time to time, and it is affected by things like the redistribution of water and the motion of Earth's tectonic plates and its mantle, etc. So this is called the polar motion of Earth. Then another one is a very significant one, which is called a tidal acceleration. You know that Earth and Moon are gravitationally bound. So these Earth attracts Moon with a force that is equal to the force with which Moon is attracting Earth. But if you look at Earth and its diameter and its size, you can see that one side, it's a spherical object, one side of Earth is farther compared to the other side, because Earth is an object with a very large size. It is around 13,000 kilometers in diameter. So one face of Earth is 13,000 kilometers farther from Moon than the other diametrically opposite side. So what will cause? Gravity is a force that is dependent on the distance. So that means the near face of Earth, or the near part of Earth, will experience a stronger gravity from Moon than the farther side. So this will essentially cause to a kind of, this will essentially cause some kind of a gravity, a tidal shear. It is called a tidal shear because there is a differential force of attraction on the opposite faces of Earth. And it will lead to a kind of stretching of or a kind of equatorial bulge. It is not necessarily not exactly an equatorial bulge. It is actually a stretching, a kind of stretching. Obviously, this picture is an exaggerated visualization for ease of understanding. So what we need to take home is that there will be a tidal shear along the line connecting Earth and the Moon. But there is another complexity here, because these are not stationary objects. Earth is revolving around its own axis once in every 24 hours. Okay, in one day, Earth is rotating about its own axis. So the point that is actually undergoing this bulge is actually rotating. And the motion of Moon around Earth takes a time of 27.3 days. So the motion of Moon is actually very slow compared to the rotation of Earth. So in that sense, the bulge actually moves ahead of this line of sight, so that there is a torque that is coming into the picture. This will cause a slowdown of Earth's rotation. Actually, it's a slowing down, but the word is tidal acceleration. This might be a slightly confusing, because the word used is acceleration, which is actually a slowing down of Earth's rotation. At the same time, Moon will slightly move away from Earth also, because there is something called a conservation of angular momentum involved. So partly you can say that if you consider the total angular momentum of the Earth-Moon system, a part of the angular momentum is moving from Earth's spin to Moon's revolution. This is actually happening to all rotating objects. So these objects, due to this tidal acceleration, there will be a slowing down of Earth's rotation and a moving away of Moon from Earth. If you consider the time of dinosaurs, the day took around 23 hours alone. So that time Earth was spinning much faster compared to the present rate of rotation of Earth. Now, in order to understand the next untold motion in the solar system, we need to understand the elements of an orbit. What designates an element? As you know that there is any object that is revolving around another due to gravity will have an elliptical orbit with the parent body at one of its foci and the other focus will be empty. So there you have an orbiting body in orbit around it. So there are two things that we need to take away from this. There is a semi-major axis and a semi-minor axis. This will determine the size of an ellipse, how large the ellipse is, or how large an orbit is. That can be the size of the orbit is evident from the quantities called a semi-major axis and a semi-minor axis. And another thing, another quantity is called the eccentricity. An eccentricity is the amount by which an ellipse deviate from perfectly circular symmetry. A circle is an ellipse with zero eccentricity. That is how you can put it. A circle is actually an ellipse with zero eccentricity. The larger the eccentricity, the longer the ellipse will become. So how long an ellipse is given by the eccentricity of the orbit and how large the orbit is will be given by the semi-major and the semi-minor axis. And the semi-minor, if you consider the semi-major axis with the parent body at one of the focus, the distance to the farthest point of orbit from the parent body is called, will be that distance will be called an apogee, and the other one will be called a perigee. So there are two words, perigee and apogee. And perigee and apogee are used when you talk about the Sun-Earth system. And the general term is periapsis and apoapsis. A-P-S-I-S. Apsis is the word. So from the parent body, the farthest point on the orbit is called apoapsis, and the nearest point on the orbit will be called a periapsis. And periapsis, in other words, periapsis will be the points where the semi-major axis actually cuts the ellipse. Now, moving to the three-dimensional orientation of the orbit, you can see that if you consider a reference plane like this, the gray plane is shown in this orbit, in this slide. If you have a reference plane, which is the gray plane here, and a reference direction, which is this red arrow, you can see that there is an angle with which this ellipse, this is a slightly yellowish plane, ellipse is inclined with the reference direction. It is called the inclination of the orbit. And there is another thing called, for the sake of simplicity, we will confine ourselves to the inclination part alone. There is an inclination there. And there is another point called an ascending node here. And a node is the point where the orbit plane, the plane of the orbit, cuts or intersects the reference plane we are using. When we talk about moon, the reference plane will be the plane of Earth's orbit. And when we talk about Earth's motion, the plane may be considered as the plane of the galaxy or anything like that. So that depends upon the convenience of the situation. So the motion that we are going to familiarize next is called the apsidal precession. Apsidal precession, you see that if you consider the elliptical orbit of Earth around the Sun, the semi-major axis of the Earth's orbit is actually rotating. It's not about the rotation of Earth. It is about the rotation of the ellipse itself. Ellipse is the orbit. The rotation of the ellipse itself, which is called the apsidal precession of Earth. It is caused by many dynamical variables like the influence of other planets, the influence of moons or orbit around us. And there are so many anomalies involved in this. Anyway, we won't delve directly into the reasons for this, but we will just try to familiarize that there is such a precessional motion for the orbit as a whole of Earth. And the period of this precessional motion is 112,000 years. So it's a very slow precession, but it is there. Now let us come to the motion of moon around Earth. So the first thing to be noted here is that there is a tidal locking involved. So if you look at moon, you will see the same face of moon always. From that observation, we tend to think that the moon is not rotating or that the moon does not have a spin, because it did have a spin. we should change the phase of Earth changing, but we see the same phase of Moon. Actually, the Moon is rotating, as you can see in this visualization. If you look at the motion of Moon, and there is a line from the surface of Moon that is pointing towards the Earth. If you keep your eyes on the line itself, you can see that the line is actually rotating. That means the Moon is actually rotating, the disk of Moon is actually rotating, but so that the rate of rotation of Moon, rate of spin of Moon, exactly matches with its revolution around Earth. Or in other words, that the time of spin or the period of spin of Moon is exactly equal to the period of revolution of Moon around Earth. This is called tidal locking. This has its secrets behind the formation of the Earth-Moon system, which we will not go into in detail right now. Just to be the point to be taken home is that there is a tidal locking involved, which causes the period of revolution and period of rotation of Moon to exactly match with each other, so that the same phase of Moon always points towards the Earth. So this is about tidal locking. Now we move on to another kind of, this is not exactly a motion in the conventional sense, but there is some kind of an interesting point to take here, that is called lunar libration. So we said that the same phase of Moon always points towards Earth. If that is the situation, we could only see 50% of Moon's surface, because there is a spherical body. That's a spherical body which is tidally locked with the Earth. Therefore, if we look at Moon from Earth, only half of the surface of Moon will be visible to Earth. But it is not true, because we see from Earth, we can see around 60%, 59% of Moon's surface. Yes?
So sorry to interrupt, your screen is flickering.
Is that flicker? Is it, does it continue? Is it still persisting?
No, sir, it's clear now.
Okay, yeah, maybe that GIF is interfering with the graphic acceleration. Maybe. I think it will be rectified in the next slide. So, it is still there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think it has to do with the GIF I have inserted. Maybe in the next slide it will be clarified, I think.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so that is about the thing is that we can see more than 50% of the Moon's surface. And there are three components there, which is called an optical libration. This is called a libration. It is not a liberation. L-I-B-E-R-A-T-A, that's a different word. This is libration, which is not a common word in English usage. The libration is a slightly technical one, which is responsible for the visibility of more than half of Moon's surface from Earth. It is called, there are three components, optical libration, parallax, and physical libration. I won't go into the details right now. It will be slightly time consuming with this flickering screen. I won't be able to do that. And we will move forward. Just, I want you to familiarize the word lunar libration. And now another, coming to the precession of Moon. We have discussed the precession of Earth's axis. We have discussed the precession of Earth's orbit. Now we are going to discuss the precession of Moon's motion. There are three precessions that applies to Moon's motion. One is the axial precession. The same way Earth's axis is having a precessional motion, you should picturize this in mind very well, because if you compare the motion with the top, that is a toy top that you're playing with, you can see that if you move it, if you just project it on the ground, it will have a spin about its own axis, then the axis itself will have a rotation. That is called a precessional motion. So that is Earth's precession, and the same thing is applicable to Moon also. Moon's axis is precessing about the plane of Moon's orbit, and that takes a period of 18.6 years. This is called the axial precession of Earth. Axial precession of Moon. And another one is the apsidal precession. Apsidal, as we have said, apsis, the point of apsis. The orbit itself, the elliptical orbit itself rotates like this. And the apsidal precession of Moon takes 8.85 years. Okay, so once in every around 9 years, the orbit itself, the Moon's orbit itself will rotate once and come to the initial configuration. That is called the apsidal precession of Moon, which takes around 8.85 years. And the third one is called nodal precession. As we have discussed earlier, node is a point where the celestial body intersects our reference plane either from south to north or from north to south. The point at which it is intersecting from south to north is called an ascending node, and the diametrically opposite node will be called a descending node. In Indian astronomy, when you consider Earth-Moon system, ascending node is often referred to as Rahu, and the descending node is often referred to as Ketu. Most of the time, people mistook these things as some mysterious things, but they are not physical objects. They are actually two positions in the sky where the actual orbit of Moon around Earth will intersect the apparent orbit of Sun around Earth. I use the word apparent orbit because actually it is the Earth moving around Sun, but for people like us who are actually observing this game from Earth, we will observe that the Sun is seemingly rotating around Earth. So that is why I used the word apparent orbit. So the points at which the apparent orbit of Sun intersects with the actual orbit of Moon are called nodes. One is an ascending node, another one is a descending node. And if you consider a line connecting the nodal points of these orbits, that line will be rotated. And that is called a nodal precession. So this nodal precession is what is responsible for the rarity of eclipses. Otherwise, the solar and lunar eclipses will be very frequent. But we do not see eclipse events very frequently because there are these complex motions involved that causes that prevents Sun, Earth, and Moon coming in straight line so often. So there are three precessional motions of Moon, just we have discussed: axial precession, apsidal precession, and nodal precession. Now let us come to Moon. So let's come to the Sun itself. The Sun itself have an axial tilt of 7.5 degrees. Sun is actually a very large gas ball, hundreds of times larger compared to our own Earth. So it has an axial tilt of 7.5 degrees. And if we consider the spin of Sun, that is a very complex spin. Sun itself is spinning, contrary to what most people think. Sun has a spin. Sun is actually rotating about its own axis, but that's a very complex spin because different regions of sky, Sun rotates at different rates. If you look at the equator of Sun, it is very fast in spin because it takes 25 days to complete one circular revolution. But if you go onto the poles of Sun, it is slowing down. As you can see, it varies from 25 to around 35, 36 days. And the day is nothing but the Earth days. So it simply means when Sun, the equator of Sun, revolves one complete rotation when Earth has completed 25 rotations. That is how you want to understand that. But this differential rotation of Sun, why different parts of the Sun rotate at different rates, is still it's a debate or it's an ongoing research topic. But it is nothing surprising because Sun is not unlike other planets. Sun is much of a plasma. It's a gas ball. It is nothing solid, or even it cannot be considered a liquid ball. It's actually a ball of plasma. So there are a lot of dynamic processes going on within and on the surface of the Sun. So it is nothing surprising, but what exactly are the mechanisms responsible for this is still an ongoing research topic. And another one is very significant one, although not discussed very often, is the concept of a barycenter. We need to understand the concept of a barycenter. When we think about these orbital motions of planets and satellites, when we say that Moon is going around Earth and Earth is moving around Sun, it is not strictly a true statement. It's a true statement. There is a kind of inaccuracy involved because if you look at the mechanics of orbits, even if you consider it from the viewpoint of Newton's law of gravity, nothing rotates another object. If they are gravitationally interacting, actually both of them will be going around a common point, which will be basically a center of mass of the system. Here it's a visualization of two almost identical objects rotating around a common point that is actually a center of mass of the system. This is the two-body system. So this is how every motion, every central force motion, even if you consider gravitational force or electromagnetic force, these are all central forces. If you consider a central forces, motion always happens like this. But if there is a significant size difference or mass difference between these two objects, the common center of mass, which is often called the barycenter of the system, the barycenter may be inside one of the objects because of the asymmetry in the sizes. Because the sizes are different, so different, the barycenter may be inside one of the bodies. In that case, you may observe that the smaller body is rotating around the larger one. If the size asymmetry is large, it might it becomes more and more true to state that the lighter object is going around the larger one. But generally speaking, this is not the case. These three situations which we have discussed can be approximated or analogous to these situations. When you consider the motion of binary stars, two stars which are identical in size and mass, that they will be moving as if in the left first picture. And if you consider Earth-Moon system, Earth is larger compared to Moon, but it is not much larger. Earth is only around four times the size of Moon. So in that sense, the common barycenter will be inside the surface of Earth. If you consider the Earth-Moon system, it is around 1,000 kilometers down the surface of Earth. But still, the point to be noted is that the barycenter is not the center of Earth. It is far above the center of Earth. Earth has a radius of around 6,400 kilometers, but the barycenter is almost 5,000 kilometers away from the center of Earth. And if you consider the Sun-Earth system, Earth is a very, very light object compared to Sun. Therefore, you can say that the barycenter of Earth-Sun system is somewhere close to the center of Sun. So these are the three situations. But if you consider solar system as a whole, when we consider motion of Sun and Earth, we often forget that there are other giants involved in the picture, because solar system has very large planets like Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune. For example, if you consider the Sun-Jupiter system, the barycenter of Sun-Jupiter system is not at all inside Sun, but it is outside the surface of Sun by around 60,000 kilometers. Okay, that will be varying, of course, because Jupiter is moving around the Sun. And what about the other planets? If you consider all the planets revolving around the Sun, the barycenter of the common system keep on changing from here to here. Okay, it keeps on changing, making the system, making the motion of the Sun very complex, because that motion is called a solar wobble, a wobbling motion, because these massive objects which are bound to Sun due to gravity are moving around it, causing the barycenter to move from one place to another, which will be causing Sun to wobble around its system. So Sun is not stationary. As most of the time when we visualize solar system, we consider that Sun is stationary and everything else is moving around it, but actually that is not the situation. It has a solar wobble. And these are the complications. Does not stop there, because there are still more elements of complexities involved which we won't discuss there. The whole purpose of this presentation was to tell you that if you want to have a truer picture of solar system, if you want into the details of the solar system, the picture of solar system that we are carrying in our mind, the mental picture we are carrying, are not enough, because there are a lot of untold motions that actually has significant effects if you approach the problem from an engineering perspective. If you are designing a navigational satellite, if you do not take into account these anomalies, these very, very small deviations from the perfect motion behavior, you will end up with a technology that is useless. If you consider a navigation system that is guided by satellites, if you do not take into account these anomalies, you will not have a navigation. It will be much tough to use a navigation system without accounting for these anomalies. So I hope I have complicated the idea of solar system in your mind to some extent. So that is the sole purpose of this presentation. Thank you for your patient listening. And now if you have any questions or any discussion to put forward, you're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful talk. It was an interesting session. Now, if the participants have any questions, you can type it in the chat box or speak up.
Can you explain sir, the tilt of yes?
Sir, if I is it okay if I ask in Malayalam?
No problem. At all.
Okay, sir. Sir, ഈ ഏൻഷ്യന്റ് ഈജിപ്ഷ്യൻസ് പണ്ട് അവരുടെ പിരമിഡൊക്കെ അലൈൻ ചെയ്തിരുന്നത് ഈ നോർത്ത് പോളും അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഈ സൂര്യന്റെ ദിശയും എങ്ങനെയോ കുറച്ച് ഓറിയന്റേഷൻ വെച്ചിട്ടാണല്ലോ അത് എന്ത് കാരണമായിരിക്കും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അവർക്ക് എങ്ങനെയാണ് ഈ നോളജ് കിട്ടിയതെന്ന് നമുക്ക് ഡാറ്റ ഉണ്ടോ
അവർക്ക് നോളജ് കിട്ടിയത് മറ്റൊന്നുമല്ല ഒബ്സർവേഷൻ മാത്രമാണ് വളരെ കീൻ ആയിട്ടുള്ള യെസ് ഓഫ് കോഴ്സ് നമ്മളിപ്പോ നമുക്കത് ശീലമില്ല കാരണം നമുക്ക് ഇങ്ങനെ കീൻ ആയിട്ട് സ്കൈ ഒബ്സർവ് ചെയ്തിട്ടൊന്നും ചെയ്യാനില്ല കാരണം ആ ഇൻഫർമേഷൻ ആർ ഓൾ അവൈലബിൾ പക്ഷെ അന്നത്തെ കാലത്ത് അതല്ല അന്നത്തെ കാലത്ത് സീസൺസ് പ്രെഡിക്ട് ചെയ്യണം കൃത്യമായി മഴയപ്പം വന്ന് പെയ്യും എന്ന് അറിഞ്ഞാലേ നമുക്ക് കൃഷി ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുള്ളൂ അപ്പൊ ആളുകളുടെ വളരെ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട ഒരു ആവശ്യമായിരുന്നു ഇത് മനസ്സിലാക്കുക എന്നുള്ളത് അപ്പോ ആകാശത്തെ ഈ പാറ്റേൺ ഈ സെലസ്റ്റിയൽ പാറ്റേണും ഭൂമിയിലെ സീസൺസ് പോലുള്ള പാറ്റേൺസ് തമ്മിൽ ഒരു കണക്ഷൻ എസ്റ്റാബ്ലിഷ് ചെയ്യാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞു എന്നുള്ളതാണ് മനുഷ്യരാശിയിൽ ഏറ്റവും സിഗ്നിഫിക്കന്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള കണ്ടത് സോ അത് അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ അവർക്കത് ഒരാവശ്യമായിരുന്നു അത് നമ്മൾ നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അവരുടെ ഏൻഷ്യന്റ് സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ ഉണ്ടാക്കുമ്പോഴെല്ലാം അവര് ഈ സെലസ്റ്റിയൽ ഒബ്ജക്ട്സിനോടുള്ള റെസ്പെക്ട് ഇങ്ങനെ കാണിച്ചിരുന്നതും അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഇതിനകത്ത് അങ്ങനെ ശരിക്കും നമ്മുടെ ഈ ഇതിൽ ഞാൻ ഈ പറഞ്ഞ പല മോഷൻസും കോംപ്ലക്സ് മോഷൻസും വളരെ പണ്ട് മുതലേ ആൾക്കാർ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിട്ടുള്ളതാണ് ഇതൊരു മോഡേൺ ഡിസ്കവറിയേ അല്ല അതായത് സോളാർ നമ്മുടെ മോഡേൺ ടെക്നോളജി സാറ്റലൈറ്റ്സ് നിന്ന് വന്നതിന് ശേഷം കണ്ടെത്തിയ കാര്യങ്ങളേ അല്ല ഇതൊക്കെ വളരെ പണ്ട് തൊട്ട് മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിട്ടുണ്ട് അത്രയും ക്ലീൻ ആയിട്ട് ഒബ്സർവ് ചെയ്താൽ സാധിക്കാവുന്നതേ ഉള്ളൂ ദേർ ഇസ് നത്തിങ് സൂപ്പർ നാച്ചുറൽ അബൌട്ട് ദിസ് അനദർ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ക്യാൻ യു എക്സ്പ്ലെയിൻ ദ ടിൽറ്റ് ഓഫ് യുറാനസ് ദേർ ഇസ് നത്തിങ് ടു ബി എക്സ്പ്ലെയിൻഡ് അബൌട്ട് ദ യുറാനസ് ബട്ട് ദ യുറാനസ് ഹാസ് എ വെരി ലാർജ് ടിൽറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് അറൌണ്ട് 98 ഡിഗ്രീസ് വിത്ത് റെസ്പെക്ട് ടു ദ എക്ലിപ്റ്റിക് നോർമൽ ടു ദ എക്ലിപ്റ്റിക് ഒബ്വിയസ്ലി ആസ് ഐ ഹാവ് സെഡ് ദ ടിൽറ്റ് ഓഫ് ഓൾ പ്ലാനറ്റ്സ് is a result of collisions that were very frequent in the initial stages of the evolution of solar system so we assume that Uranus had a pretty bad collision and another exception is nothing but the nearest planet the sister planet of earth the Venus it has a tilt of 177 degrees which causes it to look like it is spinning in the opposite direction or when you look at the solar system from a northern perspective every planet will be spinning in anti clockwise direction but the Venus is seen to be rotating in the or spinning in the clockwise direction it is not because it is spinning reverse but because the tilt of axis is so large that it is almost 180 degree so it appears to be spinning in the reverse direction all of these are assumed to be the after effects of the violent past of our solar system Are there any more questions?
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, ഈ സണ്ണിന്റെ ഫോട്ടോസ്ഫിയറിൽ ഉണ്ടാവുന്ന സൺസ്പോട്ടും പിന്നെ അതിന്റെ പ്ലാസ്മ സ്ട്രക്ചറും തമ്മിൽ എന്തെങ്കിലും റിലേഷൻ ഉണ്ടോ?
എനിക്ക് ആ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ കൃത്യമായിട്ട് മനസ്സിലായില്ല. പ്ലാസ്മ സ്ട്രക്ചർ എന്ന് ഉദ്ദേശിച്ചത് എന്താണ്?
സർ സൺ ഒരു പ്ലാസ്മ ഫോമിലാണ് സർ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടേ. അപ്പൊ ഈ പ്ലാസ്മ ഫോം ആയതുകൊണ്ടാണോ അതിൽ ഈ സൺസ്പോട്ട് ഫോം ചെയ്യുന്ന ഫോട്ടോസ്ഫിയറില്?
Plasma is actually the state of matter and the other thing is baaki ella kaaryangalum valare complex aanu sir endodana plasma annu cheyyanal at that temperature athray high temperature la normal matter nanga nikkan pattilla kaaran atathile electrons ellam adinnum strip off cheyapettu varu appo swabhavikamayittu the only possibility is plasma in one sense a plasma thanneyanu baaki ella dynamics nu kaaranam ennu paraya pakshe there are more things involved അതിനകത്ത് സണ്ണിന്റെ പല കാര്യങ്ങളും നമുക്ക് ഇനി മനസ്സിലാകാത്ത കാര്യങ്ങളുണ്ട് സോളാർ കൊറോണ എന്ന് പറയുന്ന സണ്ണിന്റെ അറ്റ്മോസ്ഫിയറിലുള്ള ഹൈ ടെമ്പറേച്ചർ എന്തുകൊണ്ടാണ് നമുക്ക് ഇപ്പോഴും മനസ്സിലായിട്ടില്ല അങ്ങനെ ഒരുപാട് കാര്യങ്ങളുണ്ട് അപ്പൊ അതുകൊണ്ട് പ്ലാസ്മ സ്ട്രക്ചർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ വാക്കിന് അർത്ഥമില്ല പ്ലാസ്മ അവിടുത്തെ സ്റ്റേറ്റ് ഓഫ് മാറ്റർ ആണ് ബാക്കിയല്ല ഈവൻ അവിടുത്തെ സൺസ്പോട്ട് എന്നൊക്കെ പറയുന്നത് അവിടുത്തെ ലോക്കൽ വേരിയേഷൻസ് ഇൻ ടെമ്പറേച്ചർ ആണ് താരതമ്യേന ടെമ്പറേച്ചർ താഴ്ന്ന പ്രദേശങ്ങളാണ് നമ്മൾ സൂര്യന്റെ സ്പോട്ട് ആയിട്ട് കാണുന്നത് What could be the reason for hexagonal formation of gases at the pole of Saturn? has it got anything to do with the motion or rotation of planet? Any hexagonal formation of gas? I did not quite understand what you mean by the hexagonal formation of gases. Can you clarify that question? And I'll move on to the next question. Meanwhile, does black holes move? Obviously, black holes are dead stars. They are, nothing in the universe is stationary. Everything is moving, and so are black holes.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Good evening.
Yeah.
Sir, hexagonal formation ki doubt vannathu. Saturn's north pole la oru cloud pattern forms cheyyunnayitte.
Referring to the Saturn's hexagon.
Yeah.
I did not quite understand the pattern of gases. Okay, so okay. Yeah. And we don't, as far I'm not, I haven't read about this in detail. Maybe ഞാൻ എവിടെയോ വായിച്ച അനുസരിച്ചിട്ട് അതിനകത്ത് നമ്മുടെ ഭൂമിയിലെ അറ്റ്മോസ്ഫിയറിൽ ഉള്ളത് പോലെ ജെറ്റ് സ്ട്രീംസ് എന്ന് പറയുന്ന ഒരു പാറ്റേൺ ആണെന്നാണ് ഞാൻ ഇവിടെ വായിച്ചത്. എനിക്ക് കൃത്യമായിട്ട് അറിയില്ല, കാരണം അറ്റ്മോസ്ഫിയർ ഡൈനാമിക്സ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ വളരെ കോംപ്ലക്സ് ആണ്. അപ്പൊ എന്താണ് അതിനെ ഡ്രൈവ് ചെയ്യുന്നതെന്നോ എന്താണ് അതിന് കാരണമാകുന്നതെന്നോ നമുക്ക് കൃത്യമായിട്ട് അറിയില്ല. ഭൂമിയിലുള്ളത് പോലെ ഭൂമിയിൽ ജെറ്റ് സ്ട്രീംസ് എന്ന് പറയുന്ന ഭൂമിയുടെ അന്തരീക്ഷത്തെ, ഭൂമിയുടെ വെതറിനെ വളരെ കാര്യമായി സ്വാധീനിക്കുന്ന ഒരു, ശരിക്കും അതൊരു ഇറ്റ്സ് എ കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് a river of gases on the upper atmosphere. So as far as I understand, Saturn's hexagon is some kind of jet streams on the surface of Saturn. I don't know much about it, sorry. So if those are all the questions, shall we wind up?
Yes, sir, we can wind up. Now I would like to invite Savitri for official vote of thanks.
Good evening, all. On behalf of Astron TKMC, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to Dr. Vaisakhan Thampi, who spared time from his busiest schedule to take this session for us today. It was an amazing and really informative session. Thank you so much, sir. Next, I would like to thank all the Exico members of Astron TKMC for their exemplary work to organize the events conducted as part of Space Week 2021. We also have Paolo sir here with us today. He conducted a talk for Astron last time and it was really wonderful. Thank you so much, sir, for joining. And I also thank all the participants who joined the meeting and made the session truthful. Thank you all. Thank you so much.